Okay, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. So today my group that consists of 6 members will share with you guys about the microbial activities on grains, fruits and vegetables. So let's go.
As we know, grains are staple food in many countries. There are many types of grains around the world, but the main cereal grain used for human foods is rice, corn, barley, quinoa, millet, oats, and many more. Because of their extensive use in our food chain, the microbiology and safety of grains product is very, very important. Microbial contamination can cause by many factors, such as environmental factors like weather, humidity, temperature, sunlight, and insects and rodent activities. Contamination also can come from humans, equipment and chemical use, containers, moisture control in the processing line. Other than that, the microflora of grains itself can also contribute to microbial contamination. In grain products, it includes various types of bacteria, fungi and mold. Generally, for this organism to grow in cereal grains, they require high water activity and humidity. Fungi that occurs on cereal grains can be divided into two groups, which is field fungi and storage fungi. Field fungi invades grain in field when the grain's moisture is 18-30% and 90%-100% relative humidities. It includes species of Alternaria, Cladosporium, Fusarium, and Helminthosporium. Storage fungi, on the other hand, invade grains in storage that has lower moisture content, which is 14-16% and 65-90% of humidities. These main storage fungi are species of Eurotium, Aspergillus and Penicillium. Bacteria, on the other hand, are not significantly involved in spoilage of dry grain. It only becomes spoilage factor after extensive deterioration of the grain has occurred and high moisture condition exists. The example of pathogens that contaminate grains include Bacillus cereus, E. coli, Salmonella, Staphylococcus aureus and lactic acid bacteria.
So, the major effect of the fungi or microbial growth on the cereals and grains, okay, is deteriorations of grains itself. It includes disease germination, discoloration, nutrient loss, and also it can give the sour odor. So the way that we can use to detect these microtoxins is we use direct plating method. So, but remember, different agar must be used by different microtoxins. For example, the RBC agar, which is a dichlorum rose fungal chloramphenicols agar, is actually for the general medium purpose only. But for example, another example, dichlorin 18% of glycerol is for the xerophilic molds only. Let's take a look how we do the direct plating method. The first step is that kernel must be sterile to kill all the microflora on the surface. Next, we rinse it and dry it on the sterile paper towel. And after that, we put in incubator with the 25 degrees Celsius to 30 degrees Celsius. And after that, we allow the internal mold growth on the kernels. And after that, we counted how many kernels that we infected. And the actual result is the percentage how much kernels that can be infected by the mold. When we talk about the preservations, there are a lot of factors that we need to be concerned of. So the first thing is the temperature of the storage. How are you going to storage it? What is the moisture contents of the grains itself? So there's a lot of factors that we need to be concerned of. So how do we preserve the cereal and grains? It's by the traditional method. It's a drying method. You can use sun drying method or you can use the mechanical drying method. And like old times. So that's all for me about microbial on cereals.
Now, I and Ain Awati will talk about fruits.
What are fruits?
Fruits are a part of a plant which produce seeds. They are include apples, oranges, lemons, plums, and compound fruit which is berries. Tomatoes and cucumbers are really fruits, although they are usually classed as vegetables. Fruits are often eaten raw, although they can be canned or dried or frozen to extend storage life. Fruits also carry a natural of microorganisms acquired from their environment.
How do fruits spoil? Fruits can be contaminated with microbes from the soil, the air, water, or animal waste. The high water content and acidity, which is low pH, favor the growth of fungi, yeast, and molds. While still on the plant, fruits can be infected by pathogenic microbes, which cause wilt, blotching, and browning.
Bacteria cell surface components are known to be important for the attachment of bacterial pathogens to fresh produce. The most important structure, which we will explain after this, is the role of flagella, fimbriae or known as pili or pilus, and cellulose.
Flagella are long, thin surface appendages that extend up to 20 micrometer and which are important for motility and chemotaxis. Bacteria use flagella to move along the plant surface before finding a favorable attachment site. Flagella enable the cells to move within the matrix of BC composites where attachment can occur. Flagella also used to sense external environments in order to regulate its biogenesis and virulence.
Fimbriae is shorter in length, straighter and monomerous than flagella. The function of adhesions on the fimbrial tip in determining its specific attachment properties has been demonstrated. Lectins found on fimbriae and flagella structures are able to recognize oligosaccharide units which allowing specific attachment.
Cellulose play a role in cell-to-cell interaction and the formation of bacterial aggregates which may in turn favor bacterial attachment to the surface. In addition to its role in attachment, cellulose also promotes bacterial persistence in the environment by conferring cells with resistance to adverse conditions, such as exposure to chlorine and bleach.
Salmonella include in general bacteria which can produce cellulose. Cellulose synthesis in Salmonella has been shown to be a primary cause of biofilm formation. Bacterial biofilm also can be defined as matrix that attach to surface. Bacteria can adhere to cells and tissues as well as to solid surface.
Limiting microbial spoilage in fruits. First, biological barrier. Autoprotective epidermis typically covered by waxy cuticle layer and microbes need to overcome multiple natural protective barriers to enter plant tissues, thus slow down deterioration rate. Second, pH. Natural acidity in fruits inhibit growth of spoilage microorganisms, especially bacteria. And lastly, antimicrobial chemicals. Some fruits, especially citrus fruits, contain natural antimicrobial chemicals.
There's a lot of techniques that can be used to prevent any microbial spoilage or contamination on vegetables. The most common one is used is surface pasteurization.
According to United States Department of Agriculture USDA scientist, Dr. Bassem announced, this process kills 99.999% of Salmonella on surfaces of artificially contaminated cantaloupes. This technique also used for papayas and tomatoes. However, surface pasteurization does not seem to be answer for sanitizing leafy products. It is more likely to destroy the products such as lettuce and spinach.
Next, irradiation is also used in the food industry to prevent any contamination on food product. This technique usually used for potatoes.
Irradiation prevents foodborne illness by effectively eliminating the organisms that cause foodborne illness, such as Salmonella and Escherichia coli, E. coli, and also preserve the vegetables product by destroying and inactivating the organisms that cause spoilage and decomposition and extend the shelf life of the food's product.
In addition, Food and Drug Administration, FDA, has provided guide for industry to minimize the microbial food safety hazards for fresh fruits.
There are seven aspects or elements need to be focused on to prevent for any contamination on vegetables and fruits, which are water, manure and municipal biosolids, worker health and hygiene, sanitary facilities, field sanitation, packing facility sanitation and transportation. Water can be a carrier of many microorganisms, including pathogenic strains of Escherichia coli, Salmonella, Vibrio cholera, Shigella, and many more. Even small amounts of contamination with some of these organisms can result in foodborne illness. Not to forget, animal manure and human fecal matter represent a significant source of human pathogens. A particularly dangerous pathogen, Escherichia coli, is known to originate primarily from ruminants such as cattle, sheep, and deer, which shed it through their feces. Therefore, the use of biosolids and manures, including solid manure, manure slurries, and manure tea, must be closely managed to limit the potential of pathogen contamination. The guide identifies the broad microbial hazards associated with the area of concern, the scientific basis of that concern, and good agricultural and management practices for reducing the risk of microbial contamination in fresh produce of vegetables and fruits.
Okay, I want to tell about the bacteria that exist in vegetables. Millions of commercial bacteria, especially Pseudomonas fluorescens, are found on surface of fruits and vegetables. This food also easily become contaminated with organisms from soil, animals, air, irrigation, water, equipment used to pick, transport, store or process them. Pathogens such as Salmonella, Shigella, Anti-Meba, Ascaris and variety of viruses can be transmitted on the surface of food and vegetables.
Cantaloupes present a special problem. Their netted surfaces develop biofilms of Salmonella, which grow into the feces beneath the netting. Fimbriae and cellulose secretions attach the bacteria firmly and thickly to the surface of the cantaloupe rind. The upper layer of biofilm protects bacteria located deeper within the film from the effects of sanitizing solutions. About 5% of melons imported into the United States from Mexico have such layer of Salmonella. When you cut through the rind, you can drag bacteria over the cut surfaces of the flesh. Sanitizing the surface would prevent this.